really happy to see so many people show up tonight so that we can hear your stories, and we'll take some time to tell you about the foundation, how we function, what our goals are, and a little bit about what happened this last year. But the focus tonight is on hearing your story, so I'm really looking forward to that. You all have an agenda probably on the table in front of you. First, I'd like to introduce the board members. We have 11 board members. Ann Ash, Vince Blagan, Kathy Rigdon, Sandy McGlynn, Dan Pruer, John Lewis, Kent Knutson, Jerry Wendt, Lisa Fern, Chris Kalowski, and myself. We all serve three-year terms, and we can serve up to two terms. And most people do take that option to serve two terms. We are in the business of giving away money. We're an endowment that has about $1.5 million in our funds. And we have two different purposes in the foundation. One is to give money for scholarships, and that is about two-thirds of our endowment is dedicated to doing that. And about one-third of our endowment goes toward grants to community organizations like yours. And each year, we are, by our bylaws, we are required to give out 5% of the money in those funds. And these are some of the purposes which you'll recognize, I'm sure, from the groups that you belong to, some of the purposes you see up on that list right there. And this providing philanthropic opportunities is really a fancy way of saying that we like donations, both small and big. We have a lot of people in the community that give their annual $50 or $100, that sort of thing. We do have some large donations occasionally, and the two biggest were the donations from the individuals Paul Sunby and Bob Green, who gave the bulk of the money for the foundation. Paul Sunby wanted his money to go toward scholarships and also the grant portion of what we do. And Bob Green wanted his money to go for scholarships in the agricultural area. Paul Sunby wanted it to go for environmental studies. So we like to get the message out about what we do and to encourage people who may be thinking about possibly giving money in their wills or even before that. If they have a significant amount of money and they have a purpose that they would like to see the money go for, we can tailor a special fund to meet that purpose. If there would be a scholarship idea or something else that people would like to see their money go toward, we can do that. So we like to get the word out, and this picture shows an idea that we're currently entertaining in New York City to travel humor here. So we do try to our name is not as well known in the community as we'd like, and so we do try through some advertising and through our website. We have an extensive website that explains what we do. Thrive and Finance financial listing. We also get out and do presentations to various groups. I just did a Rotary Club and a library board meeting talk. So we have people that are available to do that. Now this is the a bit of business that we have to do. All the board members, you'll see the minutes from the annual meeting of last year. And we won't make everybody suffer through having to read through that. But this is a sort of a recap of the situation last year that looked back at 2017, just like today we're looking at 2018. So in 2017, we gave out $49,200 in grants and $45,500 in scholarships. So would somebody like to make a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, thank you. Now, Vince Blagan, our treasurer, is up to talk about the finances for 2018.
Sure. What is it? There's three slides, you said?
Yeah.
Okay. The first slide here is the our total assets. You can see how we've grown somewhat, but slightly, sometimes subjected to market corrections, that sort of thing. 2015, see, we were over $1.2 million. Grew up to 2017 over 1.6 million, and then we leveled off this year at about 2018 at about 1.6 million, and we're up over that now. We've grown further, so you can see it's a fairly significant amount, you know. And then,
do you want to next?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
sure. Let's call it out.
And then income. Let's see, what was it again? The if you see the blue. You can see how things can vary from year to year. The blue is contributions. We have years where all of a sudden we get large contributions for various reasons. And then investment, you can see we had 2 years where we were down a little bit, but 2 years where it was up significantly more. So again, in the long run, you can see, as with the previous slide, generally an upward trend. We have a partnership with Edward Jones that does all of our investing for us and does a very good job, very generally conservative, very safe investments. There's no wild market fluctuations that we've got. So this just again shows contributions and investment year by year. And then of course next year we'll just add on again for 2019. So, okay, if you want to go to the next one.
Okay.
And then this is something we're really proud of. 2018 total fund endowments, we have 1.4 million plus our total expenses. And that is, mailing, I know we just paid a bill. Our web service.
Tax preparation.
Oh yeah, tax preparation.
Website.
Less than 1% is expenses. And I know if you look at any kind of charitable organization, what is it? The goal is always like if you're 5% or lower, that's considered very good. We're true volunteer effort. We keep it below 1%. So that's something we're pretty proud of. So, again, fundraising, tax preparation, website, that's the big things. You see a lot of the larger ones, they go 20% for expenses. So relatively speaking, we're very proud of that. So is that it? That was just three, right?
Yeah,
okay.
Just three. Uh-huh. Yeah, short and sweet. Okay, so next up is the grants, and that's you folks. The grant committee consists of Cindy McGlynn, John Lewis, Paulette Oinonen, Shelley Eddington, and myself. And in 2018, we gave out 18 grants, and I think two-thirds of you are here. That's really wonderful. $55,740, and which is up from the year before, I don't have the figures all the way back to the founding of the organization in 1998, but from 2011 to 2018, we gave out $304,000 approximately. So now the best part of the night, and I'm going to turn it over to you guys. So I did have a couple requests. Some people had to get to other meetings and some other reasons to ask to be first speaker. So I would like you all to keep it at about 2 minutes or so, because with 14 speakers and some are talking about multiple organizations, we want to make this not too late at night. So try and be concise and we'll get started here. The first speaker is Dena Duncan from Three Gates.
Thank you. I really appreciate this opportunity, and I typically talk fast, so
so I'll talk fast, but not so that you can't understand. We were incredibly fortunate to receive funds from the Stoughton Area Community Foundation this year. We have a, for those of you that aren't familiar, Three Gates is a therapeutic riding program. We teach children and adults with special needs how to ride horses. So we use the horses in partnership for therapy, occupational and physical therapy, as well as some recreational opportunities. One of the really neat things that we found as a side part of our program is the connection that families make. Often, I vividly remember a little girl walking in who had Down syndrome, who looked at the other three girls that were in her class and said, "You guys look like me!" And I think for her, it was really a neat opportunity to connect with peers that were truly peers for her. And so one of the neat outcomes of our program is that opportunity for families to connect with each other, to serve as support for each other. And we have this beautiful picnic shelter, but we had some homemade picnic benches and tables that weren't accessible and were starting to fall apart. And so the Stoughton Area Community Foundation helped us purchase truly accessible long-term picnic tables that will go under that shelter. The really cool thing was, we reached out, they're fairly expensive, and you all were paying for two of them. We reached out to the company and said, "We received a donation for two, could we parlay that, and would you consider donating?" And they actually donated one. So we ended up with your funds being able to purchase three rather than two. So I thank you very, very much for that support. It's a great opportunity for us to be able to offer that opportunity for our families to connect with each other, for families to be able to come out and have dinner before or after they ride and just spend a night on the farm enjoying the facility. So we so appreciate your support again this year, and hopefully I stayed under the 2 minutes, and thank you all.
And then Carrie Orne from Stoughton Friendly is up next.
Hello. So as Bob said, my name is Carrie Orne. I'm representing the Stoughton Dementia Friendly Coalition. In my regular full-time job, I'm the Silver Alert Coordinator for the Department of Justice, so I work for the state. But part of my job is community outreach and education, and I live in Stoughton, so I've focused some of my outreach efforts here. And with the generous grant that we were able to receive from the Community Foundation, what we have done is the first thing we've done, and we haven't used all of our funds yet, but we've purchased what we're calling comfort kits, and I can pass this around. So one thing that research has shown is that people with dementia, if they're in a crisis situation, they can be calmed by having some sort of a sensory item or a fidget item to focus on. So we have put together these kits that have like a fidget muff in there, it's got a stuffed animal, it's got some other sensory things that we are providing to the Stoughton Fire Department, the Police Department, EMS, crews, so that when they're out on a scene with somebody who is in a crisis situation, they can utilize these items to hopefully keep their person a little more calm and get through that situation. But the goal of our organization is to provide community education and awareness just about all issues relating to dementia, and make the community as welcoming and as embracing of those folks and their caregivers as possible. So that's what our organization so far has used our funds for, and we're very grateful for that. So we thank you.
Thank you. Okay, to the top of the list. Doris Burdick from St. Vincent de Paul.
Good evening. I'm vice president of St. Vincent de Paul, St. Anne Conference. Our president will be back at the end of the month. He's down south where it's warm. St. Vincent de Paul, St. Anne Conference is a 100% volunteer organization. We work totally in the Stoughton School District, and we accept calls from a variety of areas. It can be an individual calling St. Anne's. It can be somebody from Dane County Social Services. It can be somebody from START, from the police station. We get calls from a variety of sources. When a call comes in, the church will notify the person, the member, who is on call for the week. We take call for a week at a time, two people together. We do not go out on home visits by ourselves. We go in groups of two. And when they give a call, then we contact the person who is requesting assistance. Now, the assistance that they request can be also a variety of things. Probably highest on the list is assistance with rent and assistance with utility bills. And now that it's past April 15th, I'm sure we'll get a lot more of those because they start getting the notices that they're going to be shut off. And then they call, and St. Vincent's will go out and whoever is on call and see what they're, how much they owe, and if we can help them get their electricity turned back on. When we go out, we will assess the situation, see what the needs are. Sometimes they'll call for one thing, but they really have a whole host of things that they need. And we can provide a small amount of money. Our, what we provide financially depends upon what's in our treasury. And our treasury goes up and down. And the grant that we got from the coalition has helped our treasury be up so that we can give anywhere, we will give anywhere up to $200 to a family. We only will grant this one time a calendar year. We consider ourselves an emergency type of agency, not somebody that's going to sustain anybody for a length of time. We can, if we go to into a home and we see that they're sleeping on blankets on the floor, they need furniture, we can write a voucher for the St. Vincent store and they can get their furniture free there. And the same thing applies to clothes. Now, other than that, we do not receive any funds from the store. Those funds are part of the district in Madison. So our funds come from a variety of places. Donations are a big part of our funds, as are bake sales. We're famous for our bake sales, but it all helps. And the grants, like we've gotten from the coalition, and we also have gotten grants from others. And it's been very rewarding to be able to go out and help these people. Some of the situations that these people are existing in, specifically, we get calls for help, and we will go, I don't know if you're all familiar with the brick house, we'll get a call to go to the brick house, and when we go to visit that client, we'll find a mother with three children living in one room in the brick house. Not a good situation. So we will do what we can to help them to see if they can find a better living situation, because that's not it. Not with small children and such. But there's a variety of different things that we do do. I'll take one more second. Any questions?
I do. Is this something that occurs across the country with St. Vincent's?
Yes.
Okay.
St. Vincent de Paul, the organization, actually began in Europe. And there are nationwide, like Madison, for instance, the main St. Vincent de Paul is the Ralph Millichamp Center on Fish Hatchery Road. But every Catholic church in Madison has a conference. So there are people going out from every church in Madison. And that is true across the United States. Coming up in 2022, Madison will be hosting a regional meeting of all different St. Vincent de Paul organizations. So it's very much nationwide.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Doris, do your people receive any type of training? They go out and see these people?
When we first joined St. Vincent de Paul, the organization, we do attend a training session. Nothing terribly lengthy, but how to approach clients and how you should handle the various situations. Yes, we do.
Okay, thank you.
And we have approximate 20-some volunteer members at present. We're not a real small organization. And some of them have been there a long time.
Yeah, well, you do wonderful work. Thank you for
Thank
telling
you.
Us. Next up is Bud Erickson from the Veterans Memorial Park.
I'm on a member of the steering committee for the Veterans Memorial Park. We reformed, formed our committee in 2014 and decided to go ahead with this. I got one story that we worked quite hard on this, obviously. I was sitting down at the VFW one late afternoon having a beer, and we were kind of kicking it around, this whole thing. People were asking me questions. At that time, we had raised a total of $950. And a guy hollered across the bar at me, he said, "How much is this going to cost you guys?" And I kind of choked a little, and I said, "It's going to cost us about $1 million. And he kind of sneered and looked at me and he said, "You guys think you're going to get $1 million out of this community, you're nuts." And I thought, well, you might be right, you know. That's what it was. Well, in October of 2017, we had a dedication and the park paid for. So that committee, there were 10 of us, is still intact. The oldest one is 87, youngest one is 70. So there will be some turnover very soon. We're not the steering committee anymore. We have the board of directors. We all got promoted. So our goal now is to keep it going and say, well, what have you got to do? Well, I'll just say a little bit. The black walls out there, with all the veterans' names, we just added 16 more. They're either new guys or new people, rather, going into the service, or people we missed for one reason or other. The pavers that you see out there, the bricks, we added 8 of those, I think. And we're going to put in, right on the parking lot there, 2 granite pillars. They're about 6 feet tall. And they'll be up well before Memorial Day. Our yearly costs out there are, right now, I said it last year, it's gone up since then. It costs about $12,000 to maintain it. That's the mowing and the mulching and the spraying and the watering and the trimming of the branches, the utilities and the insurance. We probably are going to have to resurface the parking lot this year. Maybe we can get by one more year. But the other thing is the flags. I was out there yesterday, and we have to replace those 11 flags 3 times a year. And if we have many more days like we had yesterday, well, we have a lot of them all like that, we're going to have to replace them more often. And my goal here tonight was supposed to tell what we did with the money we got last year. That's what we did. You go out there and looked at the flags flying there. Now, put them up 2 weeks ago, those were bought by the money we got from the foundation last year.
Richard Hoffman from RSVP and ATP.
Hey, I'll start off with RSVP, and I'm not going to stand up. Can you all hear me? Okay, I've coordinated the Stoughton RSVP driver escort program now for 9 years, and I came to the Stoughton Area Community Foundation in 2013 with a proposal for our Vets Helping Vets program, which was a brand new program that was undertaken by us through the help of the American Legion in Sun Prairie, who gave a initial grant. The whole program is a program that we would service veterans of any age and any family member within that veteran's family for cost-free rides to medical appointments, job applications, any personal requirement that that veteran has because of a problem that he's having with his relocation or with his care. When we started here in 2012, we had 2 drivers and I was one of them. And our first grant from the Stoughton Area Community Foundation was $500, and that went a long way because we had not budgeted for this program within the Stoughton community. And the grant from the Sun Prairie VFW up there funded Sun Prairie and Northern Madison. But the idea caught on within the county, and especially here in Stoughton, knowing that, you know, We're pretty proud of our veterans, and they're, you know, I have been receiving phone calls for other RSVP rides from veterans. The problem with the RSVP program, which is separate, that I coordinate here in Stoughton, the RSVP program limits you to 60 years age or older, and it does not cover family members. We will provide a person 60 years of age or older free transportation within the county if they live in the Stoughton Area School District for medical appointments and what we call medium important appointments. That locked out a veteran. Not all the veterans who need help within Stoughton with our service area were 60 years of age. So this was a key program. We got $500 from the Stoughton Area Community Foundation that first year, and it kick-started this. I've got some stats here that I can tell you. Last year, 2018, we did 317 veteran rides here in Stoughton. I have five drivers. If you divide that out, five working, they drive 5 days a week, 52 weeks a year. They're driving 4 out of 5 days a week with this program. We reimburse them the federal mileage rate. That's the only thing that they get back from us. They take care of the maintenance and insurance on their own vehicles. We were reimbursed through basically 90% of our reimbursement comes from the Stoughton Area Community Foundation for our costs within Stoughton. Our costs were $6,000, and through fundraising and various other aspects, we're able to make up the difference between the Community Foundation awards us each year in what our total costs are. Very cost efficient, because the only other cost we have, I'm an unpaid volunteer. I coordinate the whole program 7 days a week. The only real cost we have is the insurance on our drivers. If they carry excess insurance, if their insurance doesn't cover the total cost of an accident with someone riding with them, our excess insurance kicks in. Then we also have to cover our drivers for what are called chauffeur duties. They're chauffeuring people. And in the event there's a mishap with the driver and the rider, the insurance takes that over. But those are our only costs. The other thing that, you know, most of these veterans are transported to the VA hospital in Madison. Now, for a number of years, the VA hospital has, and still has today, what's called a transportation pool. The Veterans Department buys 9-13 people vans. And those vans are then sectioned out in Dane County. They go down as far as Evansville, they go down as far as Edgerton, over towards Cambridge, beyond Sun Prairie. And that program worked for a while until the Gulf War veterans came back, and all of a sudden Dane County doubled their population of veterans within the area. And they still have 9 vans, but they can't cover all the people. What happens is you have to be at your point of pickup in your town. If you live in Edgerton, you have to be on the corner of Main and 51, what used to be 51, at 7:15 in the morning, even if your appointment's at 4:30 in the afternoon at the VA. You get picked up at the VA and you're brought back, you get home at 7:30, 8 o'clock at night if you're the last one on the van. They approached us for help. They said, you know, is there anything you can do? I said, well, we have this Veterans Helping Veterans program, you know, but we're limited with our resources and the number of drivers we have. But I have since taken over the Southern Dane County coordination for the VA, for the Veterans Hospital in Madison, so where if a veteran cannot make his appointed ride, his referral number then comes to me, and I appoint a driver to get him to his appointment. That gives you an idea of the complexity of what we're dealing with here in Stoughton. I just can't, you know, we've been involved with the Stoughton Area Community Foundation now since 2013, and their total grants to us over that period exceeds $11,000. That has kept our program alive. We end up the year with a zero balance in our checking account, and that's fine with me. Unless we don't get a grant again. The other program that I run here in Stoughton, I've been doing for 10 years now, is the Affordable Transportation, no, I haven't been doing this 10 years. I've been doing this, starting my fourth year now, the Affordable Transportation Program. Anybody ever heard of that? You have. Have you ever heard of the Stoughton United Methodist Church transportation program? Okay. That's what we were when I started 4 years ago. What our mission is to serve people in the Stoughton Area School District who are in the low to moderate income brackets as defined by the Housing and Urban Development out of Washington. And we provide rides to them within Stoughton and to Madison. These rides normally are the type of ride that they have to go see an attorney for a family problem, or they have to go to a mental health session in Madison. They have to go to probation court. They have to see a judge. They're homeless, living at the Brick House Hotel out here. They don't have any car transportation. It's what I like to call it, they're at the end of their road. And until we step forward with, prior to changing to the Affordable Transportation Program, which we did within the last year, we've made some changes. We're no longer affiliated with United Methodist Church. We formed our own 501c3 corporation. The name of the corporation is the Affordable Transportation. Part of the reason we did that was I receive about 60 phone calls a week for service in this. And I noticed over a period of time, people would call and say, well, I don't go to the Methodist Church, and I really, you know I would understand if you have to turn me down. That was not the purpose of the Affordable Transportation Program, but it was the conception that the public had. We had to get rid of that. There was no problem with the United Methodist Church. We had to change our image. We've just done that. the other thing, is that last year we redefined our purpose. We used to limit the rides to very specific destinations. In other words, you could call me and say, I have to go to Dane County Courthouse. What do you have to go there for? Well, my brother needs me to go with him to be a witness. Doesn't fit, you know, that just didn't cut it, because I probably have somebody has to go to see an attorney to stay out of jail, and that person, I've got to take care of that person's right first and put the other request on hold. Now we've got three tiers that we will service, all the way from the low, the bottom of our society, who are trying to get out of that hole and work them their way out, all to the people who, through no fault of their own, might not be low or moderate income, but have suffered severe personal tragedy of one sort or another, and their needs are such, they're no different than a person making zero amount of money. So we have three categories that we're serving in that. When I started, we had three drivers. We now have five. I'm very proud to say this, that my drivers, both with the RSVP program, the Affordable Transportation Program, and it's no coincidence, all of my drivers in the Affordable Transportation Program are also my RSVP drivers. Mm-hmm. With the exception of one. And all of my RSVP drivers have been with me 5 years or more. That's amazing. The turnover rate in this type of service industry is 18 months for a driver to stay on this type of a job. Stoughton's really unique. I don't have to tell any of you that. I'm working for 7 drivers before the end of this year. I don't count myself as a driver, but I drive at least once a week, if not 4 times a month, where I have to fill in for a driver who calls me at the last minute and says, I can't get out of bed, I'm so sick this morning, I have to pick Mabel up at 3 o'clock this afternoon. Well, I feel so sorry for Mabel, just because he's sick, she still has her appointment. So I will fill in. I tell my drivers not to rely on me all the time. And they don't get golf days, they don't get vacation days with me. I run a pretty tight ship, and they appreciate it. They know what the rules are. Their first cause of concern is that these people are to be treated like anybody else. Their main mission is to give them comfort and assistance to and from their immediate appointment. And that's what their real need is. That's the only thing that they care about at the time.
Richard, I hate to interrupt, Richard, but we have so many speakers. I'd like to kind of have you wrap up here.
I'm wrapping up right now. Okay, I knew it would go on, but you're getting 2 for the price of 1 here. 2 programs. Finally, I'd just like to say that within Stoughton, these are some of the statistics from last year. The city food pantry, we transported 61 families to the city food pantry for the year. 102 to United Methodist Food Pantry, so that's 163 families that were served. That's 365, that's one every 3 days goes to the food pantry. Madison Rides, 86. Other Rides, 42. So you can see that we were growing and our needs are growing, and consequently, I just can't thank the Stoughton Community Foundation enough, because they're there each year and I can count on having this service available for Stoughton. Thank you.
Lisa Hanson, I hope I pronounced that correctly.
You did beautifully. Okay. Thank you so much.
From Kiganza Elementary.
Yes. So my name is Lisa Benson, and I'm the kindergarten through fifth grade elementary music teacher over at Kiganza Elementary School. We have a wonderful music program there, and I'm so glad that throughout the past years we've had access to musical instruments for our students. However, most of those instruments were purchased decades ago and have certainly had a lot of strong use from our students across the years. And in addition, those instruments were crafted at a time when less was known about the needs of the elementary students specifically, and the needs of our students have also changed through inclusion and having all kinds of varieties of students and abilities in our classrooms. And so we really needed to look at some new options for instrumentation for Kiganza. As you might be aware, specialized instruments can be extremely expensive, and so we turned to the Stoughton Area Community Foundation for some assistance. So with their help, we were able to purchase a large Remo World Music drumming, African drumming set for our students that includes drums, maracas, shakers, all kinds of different instruments that are included. And we were also able to purchase some adaptive tools for students to use that have issues with grip and opening their hands to play instruments, so that all students were really able to be included in that program. So with that, our students have used those instruments in a variety of ways since we got them in the fall. In the interest of time, I'll give you just a few examples of what that has looked like. Every fall, our elementary schools do an instrument petting zoo program where students learn more about all the different families of instruments. And so when we were working on the percussion family, typically we have a lot of very small, very non-authentic instruments that students have had access to, but this year we were able to actually show them the African drums, and all of our 300-some students were able to have hands-on learning with those instruments and learn some basic African songs and a little bit more about the culture. In addition to that, another thing our students did this year, our first and second graders helped to plan and prepare their own concert. So they self-selected music that was important to them, and one of the songs they chose was one of the African songs they had learned about earlier. So during the course of the concert, called Show What You Know, they actually taught the audience then what they had learned about the African culture and drumming. And if you check it out on WSTO TV, you'll see that they give a shout out to the foundation there also in their concert. Finally, another thing that we're working on right now, we have put together some African drumming ensembles during our lunch recess period, and many students have signed up to give up their recess and come inside and play together with a team and build community in our school. So it's been really great to see all of the things that they've achieved so far, and we're just dipping our toe in the water as I learn more about the instruments and the different things we can do with them. Our hope is that our students will continue to participate even more in some of these special activities, and we'll be able to share even more incredible things with our audiences at concerts, and then just to build more community within our student population as well. So our entire Kiganza family is so grateful to have your support. The students put together a giant card for the organization, and they included the message, Stoughton Area Community Foundation, thanks so much for our drums. Oh wow, yay, and the drum is going bop. There are some photographs of some of our students on there, and in addition, the back of the card has been signed by dozens and dozens of our students. So I don't know that passing it around would be too easy to do, but I can leave it on the table near the door so that you're able to take a look as you're on your way out today. So thank you.
Thank you. Jane Whedon is here to talk about two things: Host a Family, It's Your Day, and Just So Stories.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you so much to the foundation, and gosh, I feel honored to be part of such wonderful projects that I've been hearing about tonight. I guess I had no idea that such wonderful stuff was happening here in Stoughton. So the first project that I'd like to talk about is Just So Stories. And I'm a professional storyteller and a former teacher, and I know that storytelling is really important in our lives, and it is a fabulous tool to use in the public schools, and well, any school as a matter of fact. And so my idea was to bring in some professional storytellers from around the area, get them into the schools, and get our elementary schools this first year exposed to what a real professional storytelling session and a storyteller might look like. So in all three of the elementary schools, we had a different professional teller, and they got to visit the classrooms as well as giving large group programs to most of the elementary children. In addition, we held an adult storytelling session at the Stoughton Senior Center that same day, and that was well attended, and the idea also was to continue doing some more adult storytelling. And in the future, we hope to, when I say we, I guess it's me, hopes to expand the storytelling program to eventually get kids being storytellers and getting them to visit, connect with intergenerational intergenerational ways in the community in both the senior center and various other places. So that was my first project that we were funded, and thank you very much for that. It was a great success. The second was I belong to a group called the Host a Family Program, and we launched a new project this year called It's Your Day, and it is to provide a birthday party celebration for children who cannot or who do not get their birthdays recognized. And the way it works is that people sign up to provide a party in a box, which is a cake mix and the candles and the frosting, as well as a few other sundries, and then also a book, because that's really important, and then a small gift. And then you take it to one of the area food pantries. And the reason I say area is because Host a Family serves three different communities. This one was specifically, this program was specifically targeted for the United Methodist Church food pantry, which is the one that we use to help us distribute these to families in need. So families that use that food pantry can sign up, and they receive a basket that they can then use for their child's birthday. So if any of you are interested, you can go to our website or talk to the United Methodist Church food pantry and sign up to provide a child with a great birthday celebration. Thank you.
Next up, Teresa Hermanson from the Stoughton Area School District.
Sit back in the corner. Hi, my name's Teresa Hermanson, and I am one of three of Stoughton Area School District social workers. As the needs of our families rise, so do the number of social workers you have helping serve them in the school district. And as school social workers, our main job is to help eliminate barriers to students, and we include families in their ability to find success not only in school but in life. And the very generous grant that the social workers receive from the Stoughton Area Community Foundation goes a long way to help us kind of level that playing field and give some opportunities to students who couldn't afford to have some things that a lot of kids just take for granted. We get that money, and it is put into an account that is only accessible by the three social workers, and so we have the ability to decide how and when we are going to access that for students. Some examples of what we use it for: we tend to spend a lot of our time working with more of the at-risk families. They're more transient, they're homeless, they're living in poverty. So simple things like a birth certificate they oftentimes lose and can't afford to replace it. I tend to see more of that at the high school, where we're trying to get our students on that path to being able to get a job, and so just having that piece of paper is huge for them to be able to make that step. Other examples that we use that money for is maybe paying for a fee for something extracurricular that the family wouldn't be able to afford. We learned that students just weren't even signing up to do certain things because they couldn't afford. So we try to help give them those opportunities. So maybe a participation fee, maybe spikes so they can run on the track team. Gym clothes. Kids are failing gym because they can't afford to have the right clothes and shoes. Those are the types of very simple things that we can do to eliminate some of those barriers. Emergency transportation is something that we tend to use that, and that can look like buying a bike for a student, a bike and a helmet and a lock so that they can get to and from school on their own. It may be a cab ride for a mom and a student to get to a doctor appointment, or a family to get them to school when it's 10 degrees below zero and the family doesn't have transportation, or it could be a gas card that can help get them to a job interview or get kids to school. Lots of different, I mean, these are just kind of some more routine examples, but I would say we are asked, we get referrals from teachers, kids directly, community members alerting us to needs, but the majority of the money really is going just to meet basic needs. Emergency food, usually a Friday afternoon we get a call from a teacher saying so-and-so says they have no food, or they're being evicted and they're going to be in their van and they need some food for the weekend. We'll get bags of groceries to get them through until they can get to the food pantry and resources that are more sustainable. And it also is these funds, it's a great opportunity for us to build rapport and be able to connect with these families. Here, we've got this for you, and let us help you get connected to other resources that can help kind of get you back on your feet. Clothing, we buy boots, and we do get some things donated, but you never have the right size boot for the right kid who's in your doorway. So we run to Walmart on a very regular basis for just clothes. We have, I think I wrote 56 students right now in the district who are identified homeless. And that means they might be in the hotel. We actually have somebody living in their van right now. They might be at the campground. But the majority of those students are really doubled up. They're sleeping on the floor at their parents' friends. So when we learn of that, we try to get them at least an air mattress, a pillow, a blanket, something so they can get a halfway decent night's sleep and be able to come to school ready to learn. So I'm here on behalf of the school district, on behalf of the social workers, but really on behalf of our families who are at risk and in need. And your grant goes a long way. Thank you.
Carly Schreid, is that?
Schreid.
Schreid, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay.
Also from the Stoughton area school district.
Hi everyone, I'm Carly Schrage. I'm also a school social worker with Teresa. So I am here to talk about another grant that we apply for every year is for our district-wide program called PBIS, which stands for Positive Behavioral Intervention and Supports. So it's really like this multi-tiered approach and framework that we use for our students at every level. And it's really to support social, emotional, and behavioral needs. We get the money donated to our buildings, and then it is actually broken up into our buildings based on enrollment, so student population. And every building has a PBIS team, and they work with their building principals to decide, you know, how best to use the money and to support our students. So some examples that we use that money for is a lot of them go to like student incentives, student assemblies and programming and events that we have at school. And a lot of it is really to create like more positive environment for our students and also a safe environment for our students. And the whole program is really kind of rewarding some of the positive behavior we're seeing, not only like, you know, following expectations in the classroom, but also like seeing a student in the hallway doing something really great for another student. So really kind of promoting that positive behavior and hopefully promoting a more positive environment for our students. So it really varies at each level how we use that, but it goes a really long way on the overall environment in our school buildings and the morale with our teachers and our staff, and hopefully keeping it a positive environment for our students. So we're very thankful to get this grant money, and it helps out our schools a lot. So thank you.
Cindy Thompson from Sturt. And Pat, I'm sorry, too.
Yeah, there's Sharon and
Sharon,
Sue are also here from PEP, so I don't know if we want to.
Well,
I'll go for Sturt, yeah.
Okay.
Hi, everyone. Amazing to actually know and recognize so many of these faces here, and to hear how our programs are all intertwined and connected. I think it's just beautiful and wouldn't be possible without the foundation, so I think that's first and foremost a huge thank you to everyone. I'm the director for START. Many of you have heard of us, Stoughton Area Resource Team. I have a photo book, and in here these are pictures of families, children, who have been helped through our program. And what I do for START is I connect to them, similar to what Teresa had mentioned, in a beautiful presentation. We are all here for those families and for the children. And we connect them to housing, to employment, to affordable transportation, to St. Vincent de Paul. All of our programs, we're connecting them to help them gain stability, self-sufficiency, and independence. So in this are their clients who have held signs explaining what START means to them or what START has provided to them. So I'll pass this around. There's a few just photos of them in general, but then there's also the signs and a few thank you cards. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for each and every single one of you who are in the room. I think START started in 2001 from community members in Stoughton who were invested in trying to help families bridge that gap between being homeless, at risk of homelessness. And that looks very, very different. I've mentioned this numerous times, but homelessness doesn't typically look like a person with a sign on the street on the side of the road. Sometimes that does, and then I'm being pulled into meetings with the mayor and the police department to try to help them. But a lot of our families here are doubling up. They're couch surfing, they're in the campgrounds. I've gotten calls from storage sheds here in town that families are staying there in the winter months. All of those types of instability are reasons that my program exists. So I connect them to budgeting, employment specialists, landlords, housing caseworkers to help them overcome if they have evictions, if they have a bad rental history, if they don't have credit. All of these different things that can cause them to be in crisis or in need, START was implemented to try to help them. We've been around now for, we're celebrating 18 years of service. We grew very, 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 I think, in an amazing way. So in 01, we were volunteers. I'm full-time, and I've been with the program for 5 years now. I am going to pass around. We have our beautiful Kay Whedon here. She's going to be our keynote speaker for our annual event. We're very excited this year to have a client share a personal testimonial in a professional video tomorrow, knock on wood. That's when we're shooting the video with United Way, so fingers crossed that everything goes smoothly. She will be able to share exactly how these funds have impacted her life. I would love for everyone and anyone to be able to come to learn and to hear more about START. So what I'm gonna do is pass around invites to our event, and Kay Whedon is gonna be doing some storytelling, so if you were interested in learning more or hearing about that, you'll have an opportunity for that as well. So do we have questions about START, or should we transition into PEP? I think we're ready to go into PEP.
Yep.
So the reason I'm also here for PEP is because I serve on their board. And Sharon Mason-Borsman is our board president, and then Sue Foley is also on our board. So we've got a trio here of our team.
Yes,
do you want to go first or do you want me?
Whatever you like. Okay. I'm Sharon Mesa Borisma, director of PEP, Personal Essential Pantry. How many people have heard of PEP or the Personal Essential Pantry? Yes, this is good. We are located at 343 East Main next to Coffee Cup, and we moved there in 2015. PEP was born by Jeff Lovell, the pastor of Ezra Church here in Stoughton, and he felt that people in need needed to get help with personal essential items to maintain a certain quality of their lives. And so the Personal Essential Pantry is under an alliance called the PEP Partnership. There are about six PEP Personal Essential Pantries in Dane County and one in Watertown. We are one of those six in Dane County. And what we do is we serve people in need who need help with deodorant, toilet paper, laundry detergent, dishwashing soap, toothbrushes, toothpaste, personal essential items that could really help and enhance their quality of life. And so we have this at this site, and we are open the first and the third Thursday of every month between 1 to 5 p.m. We are run out of all volunteers. So if you would like to volunteer at PEP, we would be open to that. We have somebody who is positioned on the computer, and we also have somebody and maybe two people who are positioned back in the stock room where our groceries and these personal items are located. We are very blessed by the Stoughton Area Community Foundation to help us with our operation and activities of this organization. Our budget is such where we are able to probably use about $500 a month for these personal essential items to give to 20 to 30 customers each month. And again, they come in, people in need. Food Share does not buy these items at all. Many of our customers are on Food Share, but that just buys food. So that's why this is important for families and for individuals. And people say to us, well, they can get this stuff at a food pantry. Sometimes you can get a roll of toilet paper, sometimes you can get deodorant, but it's not always guaranteed. We have our stuff guaranteed so they can do this. So we are very grateful for the Stoughton Area Community Foundation, and we're also able, and we're so excited about this, the 1st of May, we are going to start a voucher program, similar to the City Food Pantry's voucher program. So they give out vouchers, I think it's every 30 days, to people in need, and I think their voucher is $15. And it just supplements what they get at the food pantry. We're going to do the same, except our vouchers are going to be $10 every 30 days to our customers. And they get to use it at the Pick and Save, and they can supplement what they would need for personal essential items that they say they need more toilet paper between that 30-day period when they can get back to us. Or they're allergic to our laundry soap that we give them, and people are sensitive and have allergies. So they can spend that $10 at the Pick and Save store, and we're going to start this program at the 1st of May. So we've been able to kind of spread out a little bit to look at people's needs, and also to look, we collaborated with the school in the last year, and we also will supplement the school social workers and their schools that they identify with also giving them some personal essential items to give homeless families or people in need at the school. So, any questions? And I'm sorry.
You did great.
I just kind of rattled it off. I'm sorry.
That's perfect.
Do you guys want to add anything?
I apologize.
Is that the best part?
Okay. Well, questions, so maybe you want to just say, how many people do you see every Thursday?
We average about 25 customers a Thursday distribution day. And within that 25, we get one or two new customers as well. Just like at the grocery store, they're our customers. You know, treat them with respect. You know, it's, what Cindy wanted me to say was that I got involved with PEP about 3 years ago now, through my Girl Scouts. They were looking for their Silver Award project, and we came across Sharon and PEP, and they did the marketing and advertising for PEP, so to get more word out for families that need the products and things. So, and the girls did a great job.
Fabulous job. Fabulous job.
Actually, Sharon has one of the products that they made, the calendar.
Yes.
This the pocket calendar that we'll put in the back there. And what they did is that it highlights each distribution day so that the customers can put it in their pocket. It has our information on it. And if they need help in between, they can call or email and, you know, try and service them in that aspect as well. But that was one of the things that the girls did. They also went around the city and just hung up flyers on a regular basis so that people knew that we were available, you know, as for them. You know, a lot of times you don't think about toilet paper. It's in the cupboard.
Other questions at all? That's a good one. I'll leave these calendars and our PEP brochure on the table there. So and take some. Feel free.
Lauren Woodbring from Kiwanis.
My name is Lauren Woodring, and I am a member of the Stoughton Kiwanis Club. And for those of you who don't know what the Stoughton Kiwanis Club is, we are an international service club, and our main goal is to serve children in the community. And we want to create opportunities for all children, no matter what their circumstances may be or what their background entails. We are generous with our time, and we just have a really great time putting together different events for children in the community, and of course those events are free. So the people that we support are local families. We also support the High School Key Club. They are a member of the Kiwanis Club, just at the high school level. And then we also support the Stoughton Action Club, which is one of the only service clubs for adults with disabilities, where they can learn leadership skills and just get involved in various service projects in the community. So we have one annual fundraiser each year, which is the pancake breakfast. And so in addition to that, we really depend on the grant from the Stoughton Area Community Foundation. Those monies that we receive from the grant go towards the different events that we host. And so some of those are the annual Victorian holiday, Santa's workshop, the annual Easter egg hunt, which just happened this past Saturday, the disc golf tournament, kite day, and then new last year we did fun with cooking with the kids with the Stoughton Hospital, which went really well. And so we're just very grateful for the support from the community and from the Stoughton Area Community Foundation to help us to offer these free events for children of all ages here in Stoughton. So thank you.
Tim Bouch from Stoughton Yoga.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Tim. I'm on the board of Stoughton Yoga. We are a nonprofit organization here in town that focuses on bringing yoga classes and mindfulness classes to the community in a way that's more accessible. So that's really where our mission comes from, and that includes really working with the community as a whole, including, you know, reaching out to family and teens. And so, you know, what we really found, we're really passionate about the idea of the importance of teaching yoga and mindfulness, particularly at a young age. It helps us individually, it helps us in our relationships, and then ultimately it helps us, you know, really build our communities. So we really see this as an opportunity to really bring lifelong tools to individuals. And the other part of it is the accessibility piece. So, you know, what we found in general is that a lot of times yoga, mindfulness, you know, there's some, it can be prohibitive sometimes. Sometimes the cost can be prohibitive at some studios. Transportation can be prohibitive, being accessible. Even kind of what I call like the attitudes around it, thinking you have to look a certain way, be a certain way, wear certain clothes in order to, you know, be a yoga person. And so we're really trying to break down those barriers because we are so passionate about the benefits of yoga and mindfulness programs. And so, of course, in order to be able to do this, we really rely on the community to be able to help us with support, and we really appreciate the Stoughton Area Community Foundation also being an organization that's really helped us be able to bring this to the community. So in general, in order to break down some of these barriers, we have very low-cost classes. We do have an awesome studio right on Main Street above Windigo, and we also think of Stoughton Yoga as being beyond the studio. So we go out to and have classes at the hospitals. We have classes at the middle school. We have classes at the high school. We've had classes at the library. We have free classes in the park in the summer. So we're really trying to break down some of these barriers, the financial breaking it down with a lot of our classes are pay what you can. So it breaks that down. By bringing yoga out into the community, it allows us to break down those barriers of transportation and accessibility. And by being a member of the community and being visible, we're hoping that it also shows people that, you know, we're all yoga people. You don't have to look a certain way, wear a certain clothes in order to be able to benefit from the strength of yoga and mindfulness. And so we do a lot of different things, and one place that Stoughton Area Community Foundation was really helpful this year was in a grant that we got for our Yoga for Teens and Yoga Mat program. So we really feel, again, it's important to reach out to teens. There's a lot of research out there about how, you know, yoga and mindfulness really helps with school retention. It really helps with being productive in class. It helps, again, with relationships. You know, it helps with bringing down some of those other risky behaviors that teens will tend to get into. So we've offered yoga for teens in the past, and we've had a little bit of success. And so we decided to try something different, and we really needed the support of Stoughton Area Community Foundation to help us with this. We decided to do a yoga mat program. So what we did is we had a 5-week program once a week after school for the kids, and it was either free or a nominal charge if the family can afford to pay anything. If they can't, that was completely fine. And when the kids made a commitment to engaging in the yoga class, at the end of the 5 weeks, they were able to keep the yoga mat that they used during the class with the idea that, you know, let's take the skills, let's take what they've learned in this particular program and be able to take it home, be able to take it out in the community and continue to practice and continue to work on their yoga. And it worked out really, really well. Our classes have been filling up for teens, and for any of you that know teens, I happen to live with one, so I know them pretty well. You know, getting kids to commit, you know, to something for 5 weeks is pretty amazing. And everyone committed, everyone went through the 5 weeks for, you know, the ones we've done, they've gotten their mats, and so we just really found it's been very, very exciting program for us, and we would not have been able to do it without the Stoughton Area Community Foundation, so we thank you for your support with that. So, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Before you're done, I have one announcement. So,
okay, there's one quick one from Jerry. He wanted to talk about the FFA for a moment.
Great.
And then we'll get to Dan.
First of all, congratulations to everybody who are doing all this wonderful work. It's just so rewarding to hear. I moved to this community about 27 years ago, and I think it's just a blessing, everything that people do. And I was fortunate to be a high school agriculture education teacher and worked with the student organization, the FFA, which has as part of its goal community service and outreach. And the FFA formally got involved with the foundation. We're not a grant recipient, but fortunately we were able to start our own endowment fund, and it's led to some real positives. About 7 years ago, we celebrated the 100th year of agriculture education being taught in Stoughton, and the 75th year of the student organization, the FFA. We sold these commemorative trucks that had that information on, and tractors, numbered tractors. The profits from that we put into the foundation, started up the Stoughton FFA Endowment Fund, and a portion of that money comes back to the support the current program today. And we were also very fortunate to have somebody by the name Bob Green put it in his financial planning to make a really large donation that wouldn't have happened without the foundation and their scholarship money that's coming back to kids for that, as well as a certain percent, again, goes back to the program to help young people develop their leadership skills, cooperation skills, community service skills, being better parents, being better sisters and brothers. And so just want to take a minute to share that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I just want to say I'm really in awe of all the work that you people do. It's one thing to look at the requests for the money for these projects on paper. It's an entirely different thing to hear the stories from you people, and I really appreciate your coming tonight to tell us what you do. So I thank you
all. Yeah, just a quick note. Chris Kowalski and I are on the board, and we have been chartered this year with actually making a Facebook site that people go to. And anybody who's been involved with that knows that can take a little while. But we're now, if you haven't been out to our Facebook site recently, I've sent notes to a number of you, and Chris, you sent them to a number of people. We're trying to get out to everybody that we serve, everybody in this room, and make a connection. And so we're focusing on one, essentially one a week, although we've got a couple of other spots in there. So we're trying to have a new, not trying, we're having a new post every week, not trying, right, Chris?
Right.
We're having a new post every week between Chris and I, and essentially focusing on one of the organizations. And I think I've made connections with some of you, and you're going to share information. We will be friends with each other, and then your friends will be our friends, and vice versa. So it's starting to grow. And so it's going to continue to grow with your help. So if you get emails from us, and if we get a chance to chat tonight yet before you go, I'd love to do that. It'll continue to grow and expand. We're here to support you not only once a year, but throughout the year. And this is the kind of cool way to do it. And so we also have a website that we built last year that's got a lot more information on it and a lot of new things out there. So continue to do that too. So your friends are our friends and vice versa, and we're going to continue to expand. So please be aware, if you're not a Facebook person, you just send an email to your friends and say, go to this Facebook site. And so you don't have to actually, if it's not you, then it should be the friends of yours that are on Facebook. So. Okay, that was...
Dan, do you want to remind them to share pictures?
Oh, yes, we so need photos. You know what it's like yourself when you're looking at any type of social media and it's just copy. It's just words. And any photos, anytime you're having an event or whatever, can be one person sitting at a table working on whatever, we want the photos because that helps us help you. And we'll do the same thing back and forth. So please work on photos for
us as
well.
Where would they send those?
They can send them through the website. You can send them to the website. You can send them through the Facebook site as well. I think that's pretty clear to the ways to do that. Chris?
And the other thing, if you have events such as this event coming up, it just switched. We'll put start on before your event so we can promote, help get the word out. So
right.
If you have events throughout the year, just let us know and we'll... we'll team up with you and keep the community updated on what's happening.
Yeah, so throughout this year, we're going to keep working ahead. And we'll continue to, if you got an event coming up in the summer, let us know now so that we can get it on our schedule and get it going. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Great.
Thank you.
Up next. Next up is Ann Ash for the Scholarship Committee. And she's going to tell you about the scholarships issued in 2018.
I sort of have a dual role here because I'm a board member on the Stoughton Community Foundation, but I'm also a counselor at the high school, and I chair the honors program at the high school, which is a ton of work, but probably one of my favorite projects of the year. So as we heard a little bit earlier, the Stoughton Area Community Foundation manages the Paul Sundby Memorial and the Bob Green Memorial Scholarships. As the coordinator at the high school, I work with the scholarship committee to select recipients. They do it through a blind process. The committee looks at the applicants and picks based on merit, grade point average, and overall strength of the application. So specifically, the Paul Sundby, as we heard earlier, is awarded to students pursuing degrees in the field of environmental science. Each year, the Community Foundation awards up to 5 Paul Sundby, so the minimum award amount is $6,000, which is pretty substantial. Some years we don't have as many qualified applicants, so they can be larger. I think we've given up to $12,000 to $16,000 to certain kids in certain years. Since its inception in 2014, the Paul Sundby Fund has provided $165,000 in scholarships money to graduating seniors at Stoughton. That's not including the amount that will be awarded this year. The Bob Green is a newer scholarship. It was established in 2017 and has accounted so far for $22,000 in scholarships. That scholarship is set aside for students pursuing degrees in an agricultural-related field. The money typically has been divided between two students and has ranged anywhere from $3,500 to up to $10,000 to a student. The two funds together do account for about 20% of the total money awarded each year through the high school. The scholarships through the Community Foundation are substantial. They really, I mean, I don't know how many of you have put kids through college. I'm in that process right now. It's daunting, and so the funds really make a dent. They're nice-sized scholarships. So the Community Foundation has really become a part of the rich tradition of the Stoughton High School Honors Program, and as a wonderful example, I always think of how the Stoughton community and the high school are working together to just recognize students. And if you've ever been to the program, it's really students with all different talents. It's not just the 4.0s. We really do provide a wide range of scholarships. If you've yet to come to an honors program, I invite you to come. This year, it's May 15th. I promise really that you'll walk away feeling really proud of our students and really proud of the partnership with the Stoughton community. People, I think, that don't know about our program don't realize that it's really one of the best programs in the state. We give out more money per student than anyone close in Dane County. It's really an amazing program and an amazing partnership with the Stoughton community. The Community Foundation is a huge part of that. So I know the students are grateful and that we couldn't get any of them here tonight, but on behalf of them, I thank you for the partnership.
More items here, we'll wrap it up. New business. This last year we had two new members come on board, Vince Plagan, our treasurer, and Vince is doing an excellent job in making all this financial stuff completely understandable to us on a monthly basis. Jerry Went, who has jumped in full speed ahead, and we really appreciate Jerry coming on board. So they've been voted on to be members already, but we do need to do a bit of business here. Our slate of officers coming up, I'm retiring. I've been on 2 years as president, so I'm done with that. It's a 2-year limit on the term for president. Cindy McGlynn will be our next president, and Jerry Went, vice president. Kathy Rigdon, who has been secretary, will continue to do so, and Vince Blagan as treasurer. So if somebody would like to make a motion to approve those.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Carries. Thank you. Okay, so that pretty much wraps it up. I just want to say again that it's just wonderful to get everybody from our side and your side and all the community together to see what everybody's doing. And I think that it really helps us to understand what the hard work that you people do and help us make good decisions when we try to figure out how to allocate money for the next year. So thank you again for coming tonight.
And thank you.
Thanks, Bob.